Well, good morning.
Good morning.
And grace and peace to all of you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Welcome to this time of worship. We are so glad to have each and every single one of you here with us today. We have in the pews a red pew pad. If you would take a moment and sign it and pass it to the person you're sitting next to, that would be great. If you're visiting with us, we'd love to know that, and we'd love for you to share as much contact information as you're comfortable sharing with us. And to those who are with us virtually, we want to welcome you all to this time of worship as well. We're so glad that you have found the opportunity to come and join us online. If you notice, on the far end of the railing there, we have a flower that has been placed in the church today by Miss Jean Gaspers in honor of her new granddaughter, Elaine or Lainey. Catherine Gaspers, who was born on July 30th at Somerville Medical Center. So we just celebrate that birth. A couple of quick announcements before we enter into our time of worship together. Next Sunday, the 12th, is Promotion Sunday. So that's when we will be starting back with our Sunday school classes. If you take a look in the announcement section, you'll see that we have a variety of classes starting back for different ages, so there should be a place for each and every one of you to get plugged in. We hope that you will take the time to seek out a Sunday school class. Also wanted to let you know that following service next week, we're going to have a time of fellowship, and I believe if you also look at the end of your pew, you'll find one of these forms that reads, "I will attend the luncheon on September the 12th. This also has a place where you can sign up if you'd like to participate in the talent show that's happening alongside. So just take a moment. If you are coming, we'd love to know and be able to register that. Of course, you can sign up online through the Realm app, but if this is more convenient for you to do that way, certainly we'd love for you to record your attendance. Wonderful Wednesdays. Our Wednesday night programming is going to kick off on the 15th. We'll be having a meal that will be served at 6 o'clock, and then we'll have different programs, and the choir will be rehearsing as well at 6:30. So just want you all to be aware that we have that coming up here in a week and a half. And speaking of the choir, I want you all to make sure that you have put it in your calendar that on September the 26th, they have a special program planned for us here on Sunday morning. So we're looking forward to the chancel choir's performance that they'll be leading us through on September the 26th. Friends, with all of that in mind, let us now direct our hearts and mind toward God as we enter into this time of worship.
The choir will sing the call to worship, followed by our opening hymn. If you'll please turn to page 139. In your hymnal, "Praise to the Lord the Almighty, the King of Creation." Sing.
Thank you.
Let us remain standing for this morning's opening prayer. Won't you join me? Oh, Heavenly Father, you are the voice that speaks the word of truth into our lives. Open our ears and our hearts so that we may receive your word and be transformed. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. May be seated. And at this time, I'd like to invite, am I still on? There I am. The Guja family to come forward. What a blessing it is today, my friends, that we get to come together for this time where we get to receive into the family of God one of these young people. So I'll ask y'all to just line up right there. There we go. And if you'd like, you can turn in your hymnal to number 44. In a moment, you'll have the chance to respond, and you'll find there your response. Oh, dearly beloved, baptism is an outward and visible sign of the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, through which grace we become partakers of his righteousness and heirs of life eternal. Now those receiving the sacrament are thereby marked as Christian disciples. They are initiated into the fellowship of Christ's holy church. Our Lord has expressly given to little children a place among the people of God. It's a holy privilege that we must not deny them. Remember the words of the Lord Jesus Christ when he spoke and he declared, "Let the children come to me, do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God." And so, beloved, I ask this of you. Do you, in presenting this child for holy baptism, confess your faith in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? If so, we do. Do you therefore accept as your bounden duty and your privilege to live before him a life that becomes the gospel, to exercise all godly care that he be brought up in the Christian faith, that he be taught the holy scriptures, that he learn to give reverent attendance upon the private and the public worship of God? If so, we do. And will you endeavor to keep this child under the ministry and the guidance of the church until he, by the power of God, shall accept for himself the gift of salvation and be confirmed as a full and responsible member of Christ's holy church? If so, we will. All right, baby Nate, watch this. This is cool. You ready for this? These are the waters of baptism. I know. Let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, pour out your Holy Spirit and bless this gift of water and those who receive it, washing away their sin and clothing them in righteousness throughout their lives, that dying and being raised with Christ, they may share in his final victory. Amen. Mother, what name is given this child?
Nate.
So y'all, this is pretty cool. I learned this today. This little gown that he has here, this gown was made by Dr. Harmon's grandmother. And every Harmon child has worn this gown at their baptism. Is that correct? That is just a remarkable thing. And today we come to celebrate your baptism. Nate Harmon Guger, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I know. Come with me, buddy. Tell you about this little boy right here. This little fellow was the first child born to our congregation after my appointment here. And you, my little friend here, you are so special. God loves you. It's true. And today something amazing happened. You see, all those people, you know them well. They're your family, but today they've become a new family to you, along with all of these people as well. Today we receive you as our brother in Christ. And we promise. I know. He says, hush. We promise to do all that we can and all that God enables us to do to help you grow up to be a strong man of God until the day comes when you can profess faith for yourself. We're friends. Y'all need to know this. All right, buddy. Hang on. So, members of the household of faith, I commend to your love and care this child, whom we this day recognize as a member of the family of God. I ask of you, will you endeavor so to live that he may grow in the knowledge and the love of God the Father through our Savior Jesus Christ? Let's pray. Oh, most gracious God, we do give you thanks for baby Nate. We give you thanks for this family and the way in which you have made your love known to them. I pray your favor upon them, your blessing upon them. Pour out the gift of your Holy Spirit upon all of them as they continue to grow in such a way that brings glory to your name. For in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I invite you to open your Bibles to Ezekiel chapter 39, where you'll find our reading for the day. Beginning at the 21st verse. I will display my glory among the nations, and all the nations shall see my judgment that I have executed, and my hand that I have laid on them. The house of Israel shall know that I am the Lord their God from that day forward. And the nations shall know that the house of Israel went into captivity for their iniquity, because they dealt treacherously with me. So I hid my face from them and gave them into the hand of their adversaries, and they all fell by the sword. For I dealt with them according to their uncleanness and their transgressions, and I hid my face from them. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. There are a few concerns that I'd like to share with you before we enter into a time of prayer. I'd like to ask that you remain in prayer for the Tanners, and also that you would continue in prayer for Susan Klein. We learned that Susan Klein is going to be having another surgery here coming up as she continues to rehabilitate from her fall. Also, would like to ask that you keep Jeep Ford in your prayers. He has a minor infection, but nonetheless, it's something that we need to be in prayer about, as well as Lanier and Miss Altman, if you'll keep them as your prayers as well. Friends, are there any other concerns that you would like to lift up today?
Margaret Kiner.
Margaret Kiner. Thank you, friends. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are astounded beyond measure by the power of your grace, power of your mercy, and your love. For this world is filled with an indescribable darkness, and yet you enlighten us through momentary glimpses of glory. We thank you. We thank you for making yourself known to us. We thank you because our world can be a lonely place, God. And our lives can be messy at times. And it's easy for us to get distracted. It's way too easy for us to just fall off the path, to even get lost. But it's the light of your glory. It's this light that's made known to us at just the right times, that has the power to bring us not only a peace and a comfort, but it also has the power to bring us back to the truth. So, Lord, we thank you for being open to us. And by the power of your Spirit, may our hearts be open to sharing your grace, your mercy, and your love with others. And in this way, may you be glorified. Most gracious God, we do pray for our country. We pray for our leaders, especially this week, as we approach the remembrance of September 11th. By the power of your Holy Spirit, shape our hearts to be open to loving one another as you love us. Lord, we thank you for hearing our prayers, especially for those prayers and for those individuals whom we've named before you this day, knowing as well, Lord, that we've named names in our hearts also. For each and every single one of these individuals, Lord, we ask your grace and mercy. May they know the peace and the comfort of your ever-abiding presence. We do pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you now to continue in the spirit of worship through the giving of your tithes and your offerings. Most gracious God, as we return a portion of that which has been given to us, we pray that you and you alone would be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen. Y'all, I just have to say real quick, as I was picking the plates up, I noticed that someone put two crayons in. And I imagine that was quite the sacrifice for that little person. So we appreciate that. Thank you. Let us stand in honor of the reading of the gospel. Morning, we read from the 7th chapter of Mark, beginning at the 31st verse. And then Jesus returned from the region of Tyre and went by the way of Sidon towards the Sea of Galilee in the region of the Decapolis. They brought to him a deaf man who had an impediment in his speech. They begged him to lay his hands upon this man. Jesus took him aside in private, away from the crowd. He put his fingers into his ears and he spat and touched his tongue. And then looking up to heaven, he sighed and he said to him, "Ephphatha," that is, "be opened." And immediately his ears were open, his tongue was released, and he spoke plainly. Then Jesus ordered them to tell no one. But the more he ordered them, the more zealously they proclaimed it. And they were astounded beyond measure, saying, "He has done everything well. He even makes the deaf to hear and the mute to speak." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. So we just celebrated the baptism of baby Nate. Special for so many reasons, especially meaningful to me to be a part of that. As I said, he was the first child born into our congregation after my appointment here. But in general, it's just a great blessing when we are all able to come together and to witness the reception of a child into the family of God, which we have done today through Nate's incorporation into this family. One that we were able to do with open hearts, with open arms. You know, there's an image that's very familiar to us that comes from the baptism of Jesus. You'll recall that as Jesus was ascending up out of the waters, that the heavens were opened. Matthew and Luke both say that it was opened, and in Mark, the language is even more intense. It says it was torn apart, and that the Spirit descended like a dove. Could you imagine being a witness to that moment? To being among the crowd who was there that day, who witnessed not just the baptism of Jesus, but this moment where the glory of God was revealed in such a beautiful and profound way. For the people who were there that day, as the heavens were opened, caught a glimpse of God's glory. In the same way we've received a blessing today. Through the baptism that we just took part in, we were able to catch a glimpse of God's glory. As God's love and grace and Spirit covered this child. It's just one moment in our life, which is a life full of moments, really. Where many of those moments are blessings, where we do get to catch a glimpse of God's glory. I'm sure that you've had moments in your life that you can think of. Moments that were different from the rest of your day. A moment where you felt pulled out of this world, torn away from the things of this world, and brought to something of greater truth and greater meaning. A moment where even though it may have been brief, you caught a glimpse of the glory of God. For the next few weeks, it's the place I'd like for us to go. Those rare moments in our life when we are blessed to have the glory of God enlighten us. And it's something we see in the scripture we've read today. So Jesus is in the midst of his ministry, traveling through Galilee. And at this particular point, he's actually gone beyond the region of Galilee. It says that he's returning from Tyre. He's traveling towards the Sea of Galilee by the way of Sidon in the region of the Decapolis. Without getting into the details, all you need to know is he has gone beyond the borders of Israel into the territory of their enemies, those who threaten them. To put it quite simply, he's moved beyond his comfort zone. And he's gone to these places with the intention of carrying the good news of God to these people. He's taken the message of God's love and mercy and forgiveness to a people that others would see as a threat or as different or as unworthy. And to these people, he's gone with an open heart and an open mind and with open arms. He's traveling. And at this particular moment that he's traveling, Jesus has a crowd of people come to him, and they bring a man and present the man to Jesus. The man, he learns, is unable to hear and he's unable to speak clearly. But Jesus welcomes him. He receives him as he is. In fact, he takes him to the side, and there he proclaims a word over this man. And according to his divine authority, Jesus brings healing to him. We learn in Mark, then looking up to heaven, Jesus sighed and he said to him, "Ephphatha," that is, "be opened." And immediately his ears were opened and his tongue was released and he spoke plainly. It only took one word. Ephphatha. By the power of Jesus' word, by the power and the authority of his ability to just speak truth into the world at that moment, the man's ears were opened and his tongue was released. All because of a word. But I'm curious about this miracle. Is this man the only one who is the recipient of God's grace in this moment, of God's mercy in this moment, of the healing that can only come by way of God's authority? Is it possible this miracle extends beyond this man? Yes, Jesus took him off to a private place, but did you notice there that before he spoke this word of authority, it says that Jesus looked up to heaven. He sighed. And then he said to him, so whom was Jesus directing this word? Was he speaking this word to the man who stood before him? Or was he speaking this word to his father to whom he was looking? Ephphatha, be opened. Or is it both? This is my curiosity in this moment of what's truly happening here in the midst of this moment. For while the ears of the man were open and his tongue was released, something also happened to the people who were there that day. Those people who were a witness to what God did in and through Jesus Christ in the life of this man. For when we leave this story, we are left with the understanding that those who were there were astounded beyond measure. For a brief moment, a very brief moment, the men and the women who were gathered there that day caught a glimpse of the glory of God. And their minds were opened. Their minds were opened by God's revelation of glory through the authoritative word of Jesus Christ. God worked in and through Jesus in their midst, and in that moment, they were pulled away from the things of this world and pulled closer to the truth, the greater truth of what was happening in and around them. And their minds were opened. You know, last week, we spoke about the idea of seeing things that we can't unsee. Or learning things that we can't forget. And so in this moment, Jesus tells these individuals, don't tell anyone what you've seen today. I need you to keep this quiet. How good would you be with that? Would you be able to keep that to yourself? Of course not. Because when you catch a glimpse of the glory of God, how can you contain it? How can you restrain it? How can you hold it in? See, these individuals, they didn't just go out and share the gossip of, guess what I got to see today. This wasn't just a, hey, I got to experience something that you didn't get to experience, or I can one-up what you did. No, this was something happened that I can't explain, and you need to know about it. They couldn't remain quiet. You know, it's a funny thing that happens to our heart when our mind is opened, isn't it? It's funny how when our mind is open to a greater truth that it seems to open our heart as well and move us in a new way and in a new direction. Their heart had a funny way of responding to their mind. Just as their mind was open, so was their heart, and they could not contain the knowledge of what God had made known to them in that moment. They had to go share it with others. They had to carry that good news to others. They had to take it on to others and say, this man, Jesus, does good. I wonder how many of our problems would be solved by a willingness just to be open. And let me be very clear, I'm not saying that being open requires us to surrender our values, our principles, or even our beliefs. It most certainly does not. But what if we assumed a posture whereby we were not only open, but a posture where we were expectant of catching glimpses of the glory of God that are made known to us all the time? What if we woke up every morning expectant in God to make himself known to us in a fresh and new way? What if we woke up in the morning and we didn't let the darkness of what we see in the world cloud our view of what really is happening here, but instead woke up and said, God, just as we show up for you here today, we're going to trust and we're going to expect that you'll be open to us too. Where we might just have those moments where we catch God's glory. See, the truth is, my friend, is that Jesus is still for us. Jesus still prays on our behalf. Jesus continues to declare before his Father in heaven, be opened. And according to his divine authority, Jesus calls for the grace, the love, and the mercy of the Father to be open to all of us. And in that way, we are blessed to catch glimpses of God's glory. But also, we can fully expect that the opening of our minds to these truths about God will equally open our hearts. When the glory of God is revealed to us, we ought to be prepared for the grace, the love, and the mercy of the Father to pull upon our hearts. I want to be very clear. I want you to feel torn. I want you to feel torn from this world and towards the world that is to come. For when the Lord breaks open our hearts, we're going to be left astounded beyond measure. And it's there that we can expect to have a burning passion to share the power of God's love with others. Because really, after all, in that space, in that place, we're engaging one another in truth and love. Isn't that where we're really going to capture glimpses of God's glory the most? My friends, Jesus looked up to heaven. He sighed and he said to him, "Be opened." And the ears of the man were opened, but also the minds and the hearts of the people were opened as well. And while it was only for a moment, everyone caught a glimpse of the glory of God. And our Lord calls us to be expectant, to remain open to God's self-revelations to us. So for those who are willing, we too can trust that we will catch a glimpse of the glory of God that opens minds and open hearts. For that reason, it's my blessing to be able to invite all of you to come to this table, the table that we know to be our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, where we can trust the fullness of God's grace will be made known to all of us through faith in Jesus. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I'd like to invite you to stand and respond to the word through the affirmation of our faith by way of the reciting of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who is conceived by the Holy Spirit, Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. Third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence you come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, in your saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. I invite you to turn in your hymnals to number 12, where you'll find our service of word and table. Now, Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. We have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Hear now the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. You delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. And on the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread. He gave thanks to you. He broke the bread. He gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you. He gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves as a holy and a living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come
again. Most gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. And by your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. This is the body of Christ, broken that we might be made whole. This is the blood of Christ, shed for us for the forgiveness of sin. I remind you all that this is not my table, nor is this Duncan's table, nor is this the table of the Methodist Church. This is the table of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We believe that everyone is welcome to this table who earnestly repents of their sin and desires to be in relationship with God through faith in his Son, Jesus Christ. And for that, this is an open table. At this time, I'd like to invite our communion service to come forward as we prepare ourselves, and then the ushers will bring you all forward. You're more than welcome to receive the elements. If you'd like to kneel and have a prayer, you're more than welcome to do so. Any gifts left on the altar will go to the pastor's discretionary fund, or if you'd like to return to your pew for a moment of silence or a moment of prayer, you're welcome to do that as well. There's a club if y'all just like to find one. Body of Christ broken for you. The 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 body of Christ broken for you.
blood of Christ shed for you. The 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 blood of Christ shed for you.
Thank you.
rise to meet you, which is the words of printed in your book.
Receive now this blessing. May God pour out the gift of his Holy Spirit upon all of us gathered here this day, that as we go forth from this place, we may make known the love of God revealed to us through Jesus Christ, his Son.